All right, folks, I'm hoping somebody can hear me. Good evening tonight. My name is Chris Fleming. I am the assistant principal in the South. I'm joined tonight by Mrs. Russo. Say hello, Mrs. Russo. There we go. We have a general agenda on the screen. I'm hoping that we can see this. Ms. Russo, are you able to see that okay? Okay. So the agenda for tonight is to look over the middle school model and kind of why we have that model. Understand your child's day here at the middle school and what it's going to look like as fifth graders in sixth and seventh and eighth as they get older. Connecting and belonging, what's that going to look like for both parents and students? And then we'll have a question and answer period. If at any point in time you have a question throughout this presentation, please feel free to put it into the chat and address it to either Ms. Russo or Mrs. McCullum, both of whom will be bringing up the questions at the end, and we'll be able to go through any questions and hopefully answer as many as we have. All right, so let's begin, shall we? So like I said, if you have any questions, please put it in the chat. We'll be able to go from there. Ooh, wrong way. Organization. The middle school is organized into two buildings. So we have the south building, which houses both fifth and sixth grade students, and we have the north building, which houses the seventh and eighth grade. Next year, what we're trying to do is make sure that all of the IAs, all of the specials that fifth graders are going to have, will be in the south building. In the past, we've had kids move between buildings, and that's not always been the most ideal thing. So we're looking to make sure that we have all of their specials, or integrated arts, IAs that we call them, here in the south building. The teams are in fifth grade are two-person teams. So each child coming in will have two teachers that they'll be concentrating with. When they move to sixth grade, they will end up with a four-person team. So we're looking at going from a two-person team to a four-person team, and the rest of their career in middle school, they will have a four-person team. In seventh and eighth grade, they also have that four-person team model. And the reason why we do that is to kind of expand their community of learners as they get older. Again, wrong way. So why the middle school model? So the middle school model affords us to do quite a few things. One, it gives us people that are experts in content areas, so they get more expertise or more instruction in several different content areas. And they're allowed to have a person that knows the developmental process of kids that are at middle school age. It allows us to have a community of learners and a community for not only learners, but socially, gradually expand as they get older. So when they're in fifth grade, they'll have a group of around 50 students that they're going to get to know and they'll be working with. And as they get older, we'll expand that out a little bit more to 100 students for the next year. And then as we expand into seventh and eighth grade years, we'll find that they'll be mixed in with different kids from that they might not have had in the past. So again, gradually expanding their community. Students that are going to be well known by these teachers, they'll get to know their ins and outs, what they're like in the mornings and how their day is going, and they really spend some time getting to know the children. It decreases the transition time. So we don't have kids going from class to class to class to class, picking up books, moving around so much. They're going to stay within a small hallway of people. In this particular case, they're going to have two people that they're going to be concentrating on. They'll stick with those people for a morning period of time, and then they'll have some specials, and then they'll move on to their afternoon academic time. And this particular way, it really allows them to make close bonds and become a small community. And then, like I said before, it allows us to expand that a little bit. So the two-person team. Each teacher is responsible for two different subject areas. Those subject areas are ELA and social studies. So we'll have one teacher that will be an expert or a person that will be teaching that. And then we'll have a math science teacher. Half the work for one team will be from each. And like I said before, it's going to be from approximately 40 to 50 students. The team works together throughout the year in a variety of different things. You'll find that they do a lot of community building together. They do a lot of outdoor things together. They might take field trips or do any kind of presentations, or have experts come in from the outside and spend some time with them. But they usually do it as a team. So both teachers get to know all of the students in that area. And although they may not have a lot of time with the other group that's opposite of them, they still have an opportunity to make some connections. Next, we have the benefits of the teams. They work with two teachers. So again, you have teachers that know your kids, and that's an important piece. We all want to make sure that our children have someone that they can connect with. We're building community and making sure that we're supporting it and connecting to a larger group. It prepares them for the future years of going from room to room to room. This is kind of our gradual release where we have children coming in that may not have moved around a lot. Now they're going to move around a little bit more, and we're going to prepare them. We're going to prepare them using lockers. We're going to prepare them with organizational skills. We're going to prepare them to get ready for a sixth grade year that is going to be more independent and getting them ready to move from classroom to classroom. With this two-person model, we have fewer transitions. They spend time in the classroom. It allows teachers to say, okay, I need an extra 5 minutes for science or social studies or math or ELA, and allows them to work that through. It also allows them to do a lot of instructional integration. For instance, we have a humanities block where we have ELA and social studies that are going to be together, and they could be reading something about the Revolutionary War, working both on social studies skills and on ELA skills. Or they could be working in a STEM area where both math and science skills will be kind of worked on together. The teams that we have, like I said before, we have four two-person teams. Currently, the four teams are Coletti Stone, we have Gannon and Coronis as another team, Osterholtz and Lefebvre, and Clark and Keita. Those are the teams we currently have. The daily schedule. So your child is going to enter school and they're going to be immediately helped out by the teachers that are around them. The school hours are from 8:08 to 2:25. That's the school day. We roughly have four core academic periods, and then two IA blocks on top of that. Early release days will be at 11:25. And the outside of the academic areas or outside of the core academic areas, you'll find that your children will be taking an art class of some kind. They'll have physical education. They'll have some type of music. And that means it could be band or chorus or general music, kind of mixture in there. They'll have a library media group, which is more of our study skills, where they'll learn different skills to help them organize and get them through their day. They'll have social competencies through their guidance department. Guidance counselors are always coming in and working with kids. And then we have a lot of STEM and technology courses that we're going to be taking and helping them with. For instance, we'll do a digital learning class where they'll learn how to organize and get used to using digital products to help them in their education. There'll be a STEM class, which will kind of integrate math and science. There'll be a genius hour class currently that allows them to do kind of project-based learning. So we have a lot of different things we're looking for them to do. And they're gonna have about 8 IAs total for the year. It'll give them a nice exposure to different groups of things and allow them to find out what it is that they truly enjoy. Here we have a sample schedule, and I'm gonna stress that this is just a sample schedule. You can see that they have a morning block where they have two academic blocks. In this particular case, the people have a math and science. And then they have an integrated arts. Gives them a little bit of break from that, gets them up and moving around so they're not stuck in the same seat. And then we have our lunch, recess, and win block. Our win block is what I need block. And it's basically used for a couple of different things. One, it allows them to do some organization and catch up if they need to. It allows us to work with social emotional learning during that time so we can have a specific type of interactions with the kids to help them navigate building relationships, because middle school is really about building relationships, whether it is a person-to-person relationship, a relationship with a student to a larger community, or a student to a larger school system. And those are important aspects, important things that they need to learn moving forward, and we take that time to do it there. You can then see in the afternoon, they have another academic core academic block, and then they're gonna have some kind of IA or integrated arts towards the end of the day. Now, right now we have it so that the integrated arts are split. They could be together. We're still working that part out, but this is a general kind of schedule. Most academic blocks, including the IAs, are about 51 minutes long, and we're looking to make sure we get the maximum amount of information and effort from the kids during that time. Opportunities for fifth graders. Fifth graders have quite a few opportunities that they can get involved in school and with their peers. We have activities that are clubs and so forth that we are sponsored by the school. We have everything from a Dungeons and Dragons club to like intramural sports. There are other things like Minecraft game clubs and so forth that we have. And generally we'll say to the kids, if they have an idea for a club and they have enough people that would want to join, and we can find an advisor, somebody, an adult that can oversee that, we'll allow them to kind of help build in a club. A couple years ago, we didn't have a Dungeons and Dragons clubs. I saw seven boys at lunch that would always play Dungeons and Dragons. And I asked them, why not play it after school and kind of open it up to people? And they said, yeah, you know, but we need somebody. So we got a volunteer to do that. And now they have somewhere upward of 15 to 25 people that are consistently joining that club. So it's a nice opportunity for kids to get to know each other and to see other kids from different grades. We also have some TUME Center sponsored clubs where their kids will sign up for them, and they'll have specific times that they can go ahead and work things out. We also have an extended day program through the TUME Center, which is a nice opportunity. And then we have student council sponsored events. Student council, which fifth graders can be a part of, allows us to have different events and do different kinds of fundraising and so forth for the community themselves. You can see the student council presentation to the students this year on our website, on our transition website, and I will put that transition website into the chat in a little bit just to make sure that everybody has access to it. And I'll also be dropping a recording of this video in there as well. So if you missed anything, you can also access that. Connections and involvement for the parents. And I know that a lot of parents like to get involved and be a part of their children's education. So we have the PTO. We have the PTO that is, we want to make sure that that is growing. We want to make sure we encourage parents to become involved in that. There are volunteer opportunities for you to come in and work at different aspects within the school year. We have book clubs book sales and so forth that we have parents come in. We have a lot of parents that come in and help out for different aspects within the classroom. In the fall, you'll find that every teacher has some kind of meet and greet where you can come in and meet the teachers, walk around the room to see what their classes are like. There's always some special class events where they might be doing a presentation or they might be doing a gathering or a culminating event based on the education that they've been working on. There's back to school nights, there's parent nights, and there's always our GDRMS website. And like I said before, as we move towards transitioning to the fifth grade year, we'll be adding some things to the transition website that we currently have. On that, where we haven't been able to do any kind of tours for the kids, we do have a virtual tour on there where myself, Mrs. McCullum, and Mrs. Russo walk through the building and kind of point out different aspects of it to kind of give them a sense of the building layout. We've done that before, is that what you're saying? And then on top of that, we have the student council things in there, and we also have a presentation from our parent get-togethers like this here. All right, so here at the middle school, we really kind of work on the kids as far as our motto is pride. We break it down into almost like an acrostic poem where we have each letter meaning something different for the kids. But we really stress this as we go through the year. And I will say that anytime we talk to the kids about any aspect of either discipline or procedures or protocols that we have, we kind of tie it back to this pride motto that we have. And we talk about pride being positivity, and what it looks like is always making sure we're looking on the bright side of things. We talk about respect being, be sure that we're being respectful of others as well as ourselves, so that we can make sure that everybody's having an appropriate opportunity to reach out and have education. We talk about integrity, about being honest and having good character and what that looks like. And we try to, again, bring those kind of things back to whatever we're talking with the kids about. D is determination. We want them to put their best foot forward, and we want them to think about things and be, resilient learners and make sure that they have an opportunity to prove to us what they know and give them that opportunity. And the last one for E is empathy. We want to make sure that they understand that the world doesn't necessarily revolve around them, but there are other people out there, and we want to make sure that we're being conscious of what they have to say and what their feelings are on certain things. So that's our big overview of this. Now we do have quite a bit of time left and we want to make sure that we answer whatever questions you may have. And again, I ask that you put them into the chat below, and I'm going to ask Ms. Russo and Mrs. McCollum to kind of go through those as we're going through. So I am going to start. You're muted, Mrs. Russo. Oh, I have to unmute you. Okay. Hang on 1 second. I will unmute Ms. Russo. I am going to go here. You're all set. You should be able to unmute yourself now.
I'm all set. Ms. McCollum has to be unmuted as well.
Everybody should be able to be unmuted. So Ms. McCollum, are you able to unmute yourself?
Look at that.
Oh, nice.
Technology. Chris.
Is there anything I missed going through these? I didn't want to, before we go to the questions themselves, was there anything I missed or?
Well, I was just going to tell you that people have been putting questions in and I've been answering them to everybody.
Okay.
Already. We're working around you.
Oh, well, I see. That's just wonderful then. So are there, can you read some of the questions off just so that people aren't either overwhelmed or lost in the confusion of the chat? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to shift from sharing my screen so you can see the presentation. And I would suggest that those people that are out there put their screens on speaker mode so that way there you can see the person that's speaking. So I'm going to stop sharing right here.
So one of the questions was, somebody asked, will fifth graders be offered foreign language? And I responded that Spanish is only going to be offered in grades 7 and 8, so that students have a concentrated time on a foreign language before high school. We implemented that change this year, and it seems to be as much as we would like to be able to offer foreign language to fifth grade through eighth grade, the 7th and 8th grade seems to be a much more concentrated approach to foreign language before kids enter the high school. Someone else said, where can parents and students find a list of extracurricular activities? And I said extracurricular activities really vary each year, so there's not a set list ahead of time. The Peter Toomey Center, hopefully with everything, knock on wood, back to normal, May 29th. I heard the world is opening up, which is awesome. But the Peter Toomey Center often puts out, they'll ask teachers what they want to offer. They'll get input from parents sometimes. So the Peter Toomey Center sends out a list of activities 2 or 3 times a year. Sports are generally for 6th grade through 12th grade only. 5th graders are usually, if there's enough spaces, are invited to cross country and track. Different teachers will offer different activities each year. And the next question, what's expected class size for incoming 5th graders? I want to say like, 20, I don't know the number.
I believe
21, 22.
I think it's 22 or 23. There's about 177 fifth graders coming in, so dividing amongst the 8 teachers is somewhere in that vicinity. They shouldn't be over 25 at all, but there's probably around 22, 23.
Okay, I don't know who said this, but that's not nice to hear. What's the best way to communicate with the school? Swallow Union is fantastic. I've heard communication is poor at the middle school. How do we contact the school if necessary to get a message to a student or a teacher? I'm not sure what you're referencing, but we have 3 administrators. We have 3 administrative assistants. Reach out to any of us. You're more than welcome to do that. We have, I am retiring this year, but I'm assuming the incoming principal would continue to do newsletters each week to keep you up to date on what's happening. We keep the website up to date on what's happening. If you go on the calendar anyway, things that are going on. Teachers are very responsive. We have lots of conversations about getting back to parents in a reasonable amount of time. So you can email the teachers directly. Also, something that we try to teach kids in middle school is for students to start learning how to email the teachers. If they have a question, I was struggling with math or whatever the question are. And switching in 5th grade, the teachers are getting emails from students as well.
I've got a couple questions here. One of them was, are 5th graders going to have lockers? The plan right now is that they will have lockers. Nobody had lockers this year because of the COVID restrictions we had in place. We wanted to make sure that, you know, we didn't have to worry about going around cleaning lockers all the time. So the plan is that we are going to have lockers. If that changes between now and the beginning of the year, I'm sure we'll let you folks know. Another question I had here was, will fifth graders be offered band? And they will be offered band this year. I know that they did not have it last year or in fourth grade. No one actually had band in the middle school last year, or this particular year. So if you are a person that has a student that would like to join band, they're more than welcome to do that. And then Mr. DeStefano would be the person that would, he can talk to you about how do you go about getting instruments and making sure that they have the right things for them when they start the year off.
Yeah. This, well, I thought I was gonna have it this week, but hopefully next week something will be going out about band and chorus, about what band entails, what chorus entails, so that you have an informed decision. And if you have students in the upper grades, we weren't able to have band or chorus this year, you will also be getting, I mean, upper grades, if you still have a student in the middle school next year, you'll get, be getting information about selecting band or chorus for your middle schooler. Chris, there's another one. A parent is saying, I'm a former teacher. I love the idea of one teacher teaching two subjects. It's great that an integrative approach is being taken here. And they definitely, the ELA teachers, our ELA program a couple years ago came in, is very much history, social studies oriented. So the students are reading about the American Revolution and they're writing about the American Revolution. So the ELA and social studies are very much integrated. The math and science are less integrated, but there will be definitely an emphasis on, you know, as long a math block as we can get and integrating some science into the math into science as well.
I have a couple of questions here. One of them is about assignments and what does that look like and when do they get to find out about that? And then about what the mixture is going to be like. So I can tell you that when we talk about assigning classes, we get information from as many different people as possible, including parents. I know Mrs. McCollum sent out a parent survey. We take that information from the parents, we take them from their former teachers, guidance, anybody that had any interaction with them, take a look at their profile and say, okay, this is what we know about this student, how they learn and what's best for them. And then we kind of place them. Fifth grade is a lot of hand placement as far as putting things together. And so we also make sure that knowing that we have kids coming from two different schools, that there's a mixture of kids in both, in all classes. So that when they enter the fifth grade, they will have a familiar face, that they have somebody that they can recognize, hopefully somebody that they were friendly with, and we can make sure that that's there too. Mrs. McCollum, as far as the parent survey that was sent out, is there a link? Is there a...
It was sent out in April a couple times to all fourth grade through seventh grade parents, people that missed it and wanted to get in on it. You can email me directly and I will... We closed it so that we could start using this data because we're working on a schedule and we're making class lists now. That's why we closed it, so we wouldn't skip like new information. So if you wanted to fill it out and it's tell us about your child. That's what it is. Give us information about your child. And we're using it to help us not only make groups, but then it will also be shared with your fifth grade teacher sometime in the summer. So yeah. If you wanted to fill that out, send me a direct email, Kay.
The two other things that popped up is, do fifth graders have lunch and recess with other grades or just with fifth graders? And I can tell you that fifth graders will only have recess with other fifth graders. There'll be a seventh grade recess, but it will not be at the same area as the fifth graders. We will be separating them out as much as possible. Another question was, when will they find out about their teachers? And they find out about their teachers in August. I believe it's the second or third week in August they find out. It usually takes quite a bit of time to make all those adjustments, go back, make sure that we haven't missed something, go back again and see if there's anything we left out. So we wanna make sure we get it right before we put it out. And a lot of the times they'll have that opportunity to kind of take that input. One thing I forgot to mention about the integrated arts is that although they may have 50 students on their team, when they go to integrated arts, they can have an opportunity to meet anyone in the fifth grade. So that doesn't mean that they're going to have just people from their team. So if there's somebody on the Stone Coletti team and they have a friend that is in Osterholz Lefebvre, there's that opportunity that they can kind of meet up with them in an IA as well. So that's some of the things that are different than they would have at any of the elementary schools.
And at lunch also, there's no assigned, yeah. hopefully, knock on wood, no assigned seats for lunch next year, no assigned seats for recess. Somebody asked if outdoor activities are going to be impacted if the new school is improved. We don't use the track behind Flow Row, so I don't anticipate that it's going to be impacted. We'll still have recess. We have PE outside, so that should not impact us.
That's the hope.
Famous last words.
What kind of other questions do we have? I was asking what kind of other questions people had.
Is the fifth grade curriculum posted on the middle school website or elsewhere? It is. I wish I could tell you where it is. It's somewhere in there. I have a hard time navigating our website. I'm going to be very honest with you. I don't run it. And if you want to go to the next question, you haven't had a chance to talk. I'm going to look for the website.
Will there be an opportunity in August for incoming fifth graders to come tour the buildings at all, or will that process purely be remote this year? We're hoping that we will be able to have school tours. A schedule will be sent out to let you know when we'll be having those tours. Just stay tuned for upcoming emails.
There's a question about paraeducators, asking if all classrooms, or will there be classrooms with paraeducators? When we place kids that are in need of a paraeducator within their classroom, we make sure that there is a paraeducator available for that child. Not all classes have paraeducators, but we do make sure that those that are on, that have an IEP have those people in place for their plan. Question around, go ahead.
Can you explain, it keeps jumping around here. Can you explain how lunch is structured? I thought I saw that the kids have other options outside of hot lunch. This year, there were only a couple of options just due to COVID because they had to be pre-made prior. I'm not sure how it's going to be handled this next year, but I know that you'll be able to order online, and I think there are a couple of options that your student can choose from.
There's a question here about social inclusion for lunch and recess. Is there like a buddy table or something along that line? Typically, what you'll find is that the teachers will always look to make sure that everybody is starting off and working together and playing together outside at recess. We want to make sure the kids are involved in that. Everybody's inclusive of what we're doing. As far as the lunch goes, I very rarely, and I'm in the lunchroom all the time, I very rarely see kids that are sitting by themselves. Even this year, when I do find a child that would sit by themselves, I'm always asking, where would you like to sit? Where is a friend of yours? And then we kind of, you know, we start talking about what kind of things they would like to have as far as a group of people around them. So we really want to make sure that they are integrated and in being welcomed by the children that are around them. We have a lot of students that will eat lunch or have in the past eaten lunch with some of the counselors, and the counselors have done a great job as far as having a social group. And we want to make sure that they are always feeling comfortable going to lunch and recess.
Mr. Fleming, I see Ms. Russo do that in seventh and eighth grade as well.
Okay.
So fifth grade through eighth grade, if a student is choosing to sit by themselves, one of the administrators, somebody in the lunchroom will check in with them and like, do you want to sit with other people? I mean, if they want to sit with themselves by themselves, that's fine. But all the way fifth grade through eighth grade, if someone's by themselves, someone will check in and say, you okay? Do you want to sit with people? Do you want to help? Want me to help you find a seat?
Also, the guidance counselors for the fifth graders, they actually have, hopefully starting next year, they'll be actually able to have lunch groups, and they do it with all fifth graders. The counselors will send something out, and kids and parents can sign up for them.
There's a question about how is lunch structured. I thought I saw that kids have other options outside of hot lunch.
Already answered that.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not sure we can speak to it because this year was totally different.
Right. But I said that they'll be able to, they did have a couple of options, even though they were pre-made. So they'll still have those options, I believe, even if it's the same next year.
Somebody asked if there's a moving up ceremony. You didn't answer that, did you? So
no, I did not.
I'm assuming you mean fourth grade to fifth grade. That would be up to each fourth grade. I'm pretty sure that I heard Flo Row was going to do something, but that would be up to Brian and Pete on that. I put the link in there for the curriculum on the website.
Who's that? Do fifth Do fifth graders start a day earlier so they aren't intimidated by the older kids coming in on the same day? Actually, all middle school students will start on the same day, but we have something different that we offer for fifth graders. Their fifth grade teachers will meet them in the gym. They'll take them for tours. When we do when we do dismissal, we allow fifth graders to go out first so they can kind of get the lay of the land of how buses are when for dismissal.
Someone asked, who's the head of IEPs? There will be a cheat team chair. Right now it's Kathleen Ryan. It's going to be somebody different next year. I'm going to put somebody else's name in the chat. So if you have a question about special ed, I'm sorry, Colleen Mikovich is generally working sixth grade through eighth grade special ed, but she's somebody right now who can answer a question about special ed. Dear. There's a question about homework, you guys.
Oh, homework policy. Generally, when we're talking about homework with students, we do 10 minutes per grade. So you're looking at about 50 minutes. Does that mean that every day they're going to have 50 minutes of homework? Nope, that doesn't mean that. Should they be spending 2-3 hours on homework? Definitely not. We don't want students stressing out about homework when they're in fifth grade. We stress to the teachers that we want to make sure that homework is both relevant and rigorous for what they're trying to have them do. So we don't want to give homework just for the sake of giving homework, and we don't want to give things like, oh, color this, please, and as a piece of homework, because that might not be an effective use of the child's time. We want to make sure that the homework that they're getting is, like I said, relevant, and making sure that it is going to give them some kind of benefit. With that being said, it's around 50 minutes. Some kids will take a little longer, some kids will do it a little quicker, but it should be around that time. Other questions?
I'm driving, so can I ask a question out loud? I'm sorry.
Have at it.
Okay. I have two questions. One is, what's the technology that's required for fifth graders? And the second question is, when do we get instructions on signing them up for IAs? Because we sign them up for that. Is that correct? Or are they assigned?
Nope, that's okay. So the
IA. Their extracurricular, the art, music.
Yep. So the IAs are assigned to all students. There's not any, choice in that. Their first year, we want to make sure that they get a little bit of everything so that they can really, you know, kind of experience all of them together. So there's no difference from grade to grade. When they might have it might be a little different. We might have students that have music at the beginning of the year and something else at the end of the year. It could vary that way. And your other question, I'm sorry, I forgot the other question. Can you please say that one more time?
just the technology, there's.
So we're a one-to-one school. So everybody will have access to a Chromebook. And that means that they'll come into school, whether the teachers choose to do everything on the Chromebook or not, that's depending upon the team. I can tell you that when I spoke with most teachers, they had said that they found that this year they were over the top with digital learning. And they really want to scale that back and get more hands-on with things they're doing. But kids will get a Chromebook. They'll be asked to bring any earbuds in or something that they can listen to anything that they're doing on the computer, whether it be a video or music or anything along those lines. Other than that, they'll carry those Chromebooks around with them from class to class. As far as, you know, home-based stuff, I don't believe we're going to be sending Chromebooks home next year, but I'm not sure at this point. So I can't really give too much information on that. Did I answer your questions for you?
Yes, thank you. I appreciate it.
Sure.
Somebody said, I was told by my son the fifth grade can do track and field and cross country. That is true. If there's room on the team, they have to have, I don't know, one of those is rec is now, I guess. I don't know what track and field is now. I think they have 4 coaches, so they have to make sure they have enough coaches because they will have like 60 kids on the team. So if there's enough room, and the last few years there has been, fifth graders will be a part of that. This question about school supplies, will back to school supplies be mailed out to parents? The teachers are working on those lists right now, and I told them I would send it to parents the week the school's out this year, June 14th. I will send it out to all fourth grade parents. Here's the back to school supplies. It will also be posted on the website, and I'm assuming the new principal would send it out later in the year as well.
There's a question about late buses for those kids that go to after school activities. And unfortunately, we do not have late buses. That is totally a parent pickup part of our program. Can parents volunteer to help the track and field team coaches? That is based on two different things. One, whether the athletic department would allow that to happen, and that is not part necessarily of the middle school itself. You'd have to talk to Matt Ricard, who's the athletic director, and then it would be the track coach or the coach's responsibility from there to invite parents in. I haven't seen parents do it. That doesn't mean they can't do it. But again, it would be those two people that would really have that say whether they can do that or not.
We do have parents who kind of like in an unofficial thing will show up and will support the team and will support kids, you know, practicing or running or whatever. So I'm sure that it would be welcome, but we would just definitely want to go through Matt Ricard. He is the athletic director at the high school. And they run, we don't run our own sports program. He runs it.
There's a question about where fifth graders would sit on the bus. Generally, as fifth through eighth graders get on the bus, fifth graders sit closer to the front of the bus, then come sixth graders, seventh graders, and eighth graders kind of sit in the way back. We encourage it to be that way. Do sometimes fifth graders get up and go to the back of the bus to sit with eighth graders, an older sibling or something? It happens. But in general, we say that fifth graders should be closer to the front of the bus. Sixth graders, seventh graders, and eighth graders kind of progress as they go down the aisle.
I will say that that is often one of the biggest concerns that I've seen of parents sending their kids to middle school is the bus. What's going to happen on the bus? Before I was here, I was in a kindergarten through eighth grade school. So kindergarten through eighth, so 5-year-olds to 14-year-olds were on the bus. And they was always very fearful. And by and large, it's not a concern. The kids are managed on the bus. If they're not, we hear about it. Chris and Ann do a great job in terms of helping kids learn the correct behavior on the bus, but it works out. It works out well. We do encourage you to encourage your child to sit towards the front of the bus. There's no need for a fifth grader to be sitting back with the eighth graders. I don't see any other questions.
Yeah, are there any other questions that we can answer for you? I know that this is one of those things where you're like, oh, I'm going to forget about it. And, you know, feel free to, you know, come back later on, send us questions. I can tell you that we've done a Zoom with your children already in both Swallow and Flow Row. We've kind of done some work with them. I extended an invitation to the teachers of both Swallow and Flow Row that I can come and visit them and answer some more questions, because again, not all questions get answered the first time. You might think of it, you'd be driving home or you'd be driving someplace and be like, oh, I should have asked. But you know, feel free to shoot us an email and let us know. And again, I will get information out tomorrow in a ConnectEd, I think it's called ConnectEd.
School Messenger.
School Messenger, thank you. I never get it right because my kids have ConnectEd. We'll get it out in School Messenger to say that this is the website that you can see the transitions on, and we can go from there. There's one last question that asks about additional languages at the middle school. There's only one language that's offered middle school and high school at this point, and Spanish. There's no other language that's being offered at this time. So that's all I can say about that. So if you have further questions, please feel free to email us. Mrs. McCullum has put our email addresses in the chat. Again, thank you for coming. And we look forward to seeing your children in the fall and hopefully you as well. So
please definitely look at the, Chris, are you going to send them the link? Did you put that in?
I'm going to send them the link tomorrow in that school messenger.
But definitely look at the website link. Oh, sorry. I was paying attention. Don't worry.
I know.
Because there is a slideshow in there that student council did.
It is.
So student council, we asked them, can you make a slideshow for incoming fifth graders? And there's this awesome little interview. There's a fifth grade girl and a sixth grade boy. And they made up the questions. They decided what kinds of things would fifth graders want to know. Thank you, Stephanie. what kind of things would fifth graders want to know? And the sixth grade boy asks the fifth grade girl the questions and she gives the answers. It is awesome and it's so fun to watch. I've watched it like four times. I keep learning about middle school. It's so cool. And then the rest of the student council wanted in on it. So they made a whole slideshow. They decided what it is parents and kids would want to know. So they did this awesome slideshow, and your children have already, I believe, seen it. Their fourth grade teachers were asked to share it with them, but that would be kind of a cool thing. Maybe later in the summer when they're getting ready for middle school, that they could check that out again.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Again, thank you folks for coming, and we definitely appreciate you, and we look forward to seeing you and your kids in the fall. So have a wonderful night. Thank you for coming. Bye now.